Hello, you're listening to Sri Export, and I'm your host, Srinivas. In this podcast, I'll be in conversation with my friends on diverse topics. I aspire to learn something new and share the knowledge with you all. I hope you'll like it. Today, we are joined by Srikar and Mansa. Srikar writes poetry, blogs, and short stories, whereas Mansa is a bibliophile. We are going to discuss poetry and books in this episode. Hope you enjoy that. Hello, Mansa. Hi, Srikar.
Hi, Srinivas.
Hello, Shru.
Hi.
Hi, Srikar.
Hi, Mansa.
How are you guys doing?
Awesome. How are you?
I'm great. How are you, Mansa?
I am thrilled and terrified to be here. And also, Shru gently persuaded me into doing this.
I had to. Yeah. I needed a co-host, you know. Yeah. So, what are you guys doing these days, you know, in this lockdown?
Right now, I'm exploring more writing forms. I'm taking some courses on writing. I'm also exploring a few video editing courses.
Okay.
I'm planning to open a YouTube channel for my poetry.
Okay.
So, that's it.
You are from what branch of engineering?
I am from electrical.
Electrical, okay. And do you still pursue anything in electrical engineering?
Yeah. I'm planning to write GATE.
Okay.
I'm preparing for it. Okay. But also, side by side, I'm doing these writing courses too.
Nice. And what about you, Mansa?
Don't even ask. I feel so unproductive after listening to what Srikar said. I am like merely binge-watching TV shows and also doing what I love the most, reading books.
Oh, what are you reading currently?
I am currently reading The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy.
Amazing. I have heard about that book. I will borrow it from you someday. You know.
You can, but I would just like to say it's going good. Like, just fair.
Nice. And
And
Srikar, are you reading anything currently?
Yeah, I'm reading two books. One of them is Unposted Letter by Mahathriyara.
Okay.
And the other one is Atlas Shrugged by Ayn Rand.
Hmm. What are they about?
Unposted Letter is about the author's perspectives on life. It's about more of spirituality and also like what are his views on life. I know like many are familiar with Mahathriyara, I guess. He is a motivational speaker on YouTube.
Okay.
So his views and all that. And Ayn Rand is a great writer. Atlas Shrugged is one of her best works. It's about what if the people who run the world, like who are authentic and who are originators, inventors, if they go on a strike, what happens to the world? That's the theme of the story.
I think I need to read that book considering what is happening in India these days.
Yeah.
I mean, I have this problem. That I start reading books, but you know, in between I just keep them aside. I don't know, I get involved with other things, you know. It's not like I lose my interest, but I'll develop other interests as well, so it's like shifting from one thing to other. So how did you develop this habit of reading books?
Firstly, when I was in my second year, I was following these people on Instagram, Elon Musk, and Tony Robbins, Gary Vee, all these people. And okay. There was one thing in common among them, that they all are readers. Elon Musk read a lot. He read a lot of science fiction, which now is converting into a reality. So all these people have read. Then I thought like, it's a trait that many successful people share. So I want to be successful too. So let me imitate them in this fashion so that I can get the same results. So I started reading books. I started picking up fiction. Then I fell in love with fiction writing, the storytelling, art of storytelling.
Okay.
Then later on, I shifted to nonfiction too. Nonfiction is also great. There are many great books out there.
Yeah, looking at your stories, most of the times you are reading nonfiction, I guess, these days.
The point is that I like turning ideas into stories. Okay. I like I read nonfiction and I develop new perspectives. I love turning them into stories.
Good. And I don't have to ask Mansa because, you know, her interests are just similar to mine. You know, okay. They are wide, but similar to mine. She reads many genres altogether. But Mansa, which is your favorite genre?
Well, first of all, unlike Shrikar, I really don't have a motive behind reading, okay. Like reading books. Mm. So I generally read like almost like a melange of all the genres, but I'm a tad inclined to romance.
Nice. So does that explain your filmy side also?
Totally.
Nice. And what was your first novel that you read?
Oh, first novel. I think it was gifted to me by my grandfather, which I obviously did not finish. It was The Experiments with Truth by M.K. Gandhi.
Wow.
But obviously I didn't finish. Guys, don't laugh, okay? I tried reading it, but I was really young.
I can understand. At that age, probably I was just reading comic books and some story books. That's it.
I know, right? I asked him for them, but he was like, no, you should read these books. And I barely used to get myself to read like one or two pages every day.
Probably that propelled you to become who you are today.
I think so. And also, but like consciously, I remember picking up my first book from an airport just because I just wanted to read on the plane. One of my bucket lists.
Okay.
So like I just picked up a random book. So it was called, I think, Like a Love Song by Preeti Shenoy. I just liked the cover, so I bought it.
Nice. And Shrikar, are you also into romance genre?
No, I'm not into romance genre.
What?
haven't read much of romance. But the point is, I started reading books by starting from romance genre.
Okay.
I picked up a book called, it's titled 1,000 Love Letters by Shwetab Gangwal. He's a YouTuber and he also writes. So with that, I started reading. I fell in love with the usage of his language style. It's the way he presented those emotions. That was awesome. Then I shifted to some other genre, horror, suspense thriller.
Okay.
But that romance didn't carry further.
You know, I didn't know this, that Shwetab Gangwar had any romance genre book.
Many of them don't know that. It was his first book. It was not a big hit.
Okay. I haven't read the most popular book, which is The Rudest Book Ever. Yet, you know, whenever I watch him on YouTube, he makes this podcast. And man, he's amazing. The points he makes and everything that, you know, is written in the book, he presents there in the videos as well. And that is very helpful because, you know, that becomes the selling point for the book as well. You know, people get attracted towards it. And that is a very, very smart marketing also. So, do you think there is a book out there which has shaped you the most?
Well, I think there is this book called The Magic of Thinking Big by David Schwartz.
Okay.
So, I think it has... Okay, let's just say it has helped me get out of bed and actually do stuff. And I also have a quote from the book as my wallpaper. Let me just read it out. It says, think doubt and fail, think victory and succeed.
Good.
So it's just a very nice, subtle way of putting into perspective that it all depends on how you think.
I don't know how you people do this, but, you know, many times I saw Shrikar's stories where he put pages of the books that he's reading. He underlines many lines. He underlines the quotes and the influential lines. And I never understood it because that kind of operation needs a lot of concentration, you know. Whenever you are reading book, you need to... you know, get involved so much that, you know, you will find something very interesting in that particular line. and you are, you know, forced to just underline it so that you, whenever you come back again, okay,
yeah,
you get the same thought, you get the same feeling about the line, and that is very great. And Srikar, is there any book out there which has made you underline so many such words and shaped you today in what you are?
Yeah, it's The Power of Habit by Charles Duhigg.
Okay.
I love that book. If anyone wants to know themselves, like how, like why they are doing the things they have been doing, then they have to pick up The Power of Habit. It's like, in simple words, we are nothing but just habits. We are our habits. So he explains he breaks down the function of the habit, like how we form the habits, how we break the habits, how we are into the habits. So once we understand the mechanics of habits, then we can tweak them then we can tweak them and we can become more productive. And also, once we form a habit, we don't do it consciously. If we are driving a car, we don't do it consciously. Like if you are, it's almost like 30% conscious. You know, if you are parking a car, you do it just like that, because all that consciousness turns into body memory. That's the goal. Even athletes do the same. They all on the field. Yeah, that's what I love that part.
Yeah.
Shrikar, I'm just asking this out of curiosity. Did you happen to read Atomic Habits by James Clear?
I'm planning to read it. I haven't read it, but it's on my book list.
I just heard the way you described it, and I think it's strikingly similar to Atomic Habits.
Yeah,
it's books. Almost, I think they both are the same, because it's the Atomic Habits is also about how you induce habits into your life and they just sort of become a part of who you are.
Yeah.
And the part where you mentioned that athletes also train their habits into muscle memories, you know, when a cricketer hits a ball, it becomes his muscle memory that when a ball comes this way, you have to hit this type of shot. You know, that becomes a muscle memory. And I think that kind of phenomenon can be used in different ways also. I think that is how those books help you, right? And do you plan to write an autobiography of yours?
Such a nice question.
This is a straightforward big question, because I'm just curious, since so many people read, they also wanna write their autobiography or write a book that transfers all their thoughts into writing.
Listen, you know my book is going to be super fat if it's about me.
And very complex as well.
Very complex. And so, okay, I just came up like, okay, I'm just going to say it. I think my autobiography is going to be named Unpredictable. I'm not saying this to sound cool or anything. Trust me. It's exactly who I am. And Shru will agree with me. Like, I'm clueless. I don't know what I'll be doing in the next moment.
I
think Unpredictable would be like a really good title for my autobiography.
Totally.
What about you, Shrikar?
Firstly, I would read your book, Unpredictable.
and then decide whether to write or not.
Well, Shrikar, you're going to be so old.
I don't know if I want to.
I hope your kids also enjoy my book.
I don't know. It's titled Unpredictable.
Nice.
Oh my god. Okay, I'll take it as a compliment.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm just taking it, huh?
Okay. So Srikar, have you planned on writing of yours?
I haven't planned it, but I wish for that to happen, because in order to write autobiography, one should have a legacy, right?
Not really, but okay.
But I prefer to have a legacy than write an autobiography. So that, it should be like an inspiration for the next generation.
Why does it have to be like that? Why do you have to, you know, create a legacy to write a book? Why can't you be just a normal person and then write an autobiography?
like it's not necessary to have a legacy to write an autobiography, but I prefer to have a legacy and write an autobiography.
Okay,
it's a personal preference, that's it, nothing else. Yes.
So you think if you write something that should influence people or that should help somebody, otherwise it's futile?
Yeah, that's what. Now, if you want to pick up an autobiography, would you pick up a normal person's or would you pick up a famous person from whom you can learn something?
Yeah.
And get inspired.
Yeah, true.
Excuse me? You can also read books for just entertainment, okay?
Yeah,
we can do that, but...
Exactly.
But on a larger scale...
Shru, you have called two completely opposite people onto this podcast.
Yeah, you know, my purpose is fulfilled.
More content.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Anyway, I think if Mansa goes to a bookshop and she has two autobiographies, one of Michelle Obama and the other of Kardashians, I think she will pick up...
Oh my God, that is so tough.
I think she will pick up Michelle Obama's autobiography, but also thinking about Kardashian's autobiography. She doesn't want to lose the sass. Okay, she doesn't want to lose.
I swear.
Yeah, she wants all the gossip, okay, in the world.
Shrika, see, now you know why I named my autobiography Unpredictable.
Yeah. Now I got it.
I might just pick up Kardashians, go home and feel bad also again.
Again, yeah, yeah, that can happen because she has read Michelle Obama book, right? Becoming.
Yeah, Becoming.
Yeah, how was that? Book. How was that experience?
I think Becoming is easily one of like my favorite books. It's obviously written by Michelle Obama. It's a memoir. And it's also about how, you know, Michelle, being a woman of color, fought her way through all the injustices that, you know, that she faced and found her voice. And also when life hasn't really been easy for her, you know, and even when she was, the media sort of picked up on her and criticized her very unfairly.
Okay.
And we, you know, it's really surprising that we all assume that celebrities aren't usually affected by all of this, mm-hmm. but they actually do get affected by all of this.
Definitely.
And so like basically the book is about how she is just more than, you know, the president's wife.
Okay. Nice.
I'd recommend both of you to read it.
Yeah, sure, definitely. I'll do that.
Any book that you would gift the most?
I would gift a couple of books. First one is The Rudest Book Ever by Shweta Gangwar, and the second one is Unposted Letter. Okay. Both are quite different. One is too intense, one is subtle, but it's a great mixture. Like one should read those two books to have a wider perspective, to expand their horizon of perspectives about life and society.
Okay. So whenever we talk about these influential personalities, why do we always look towards somebody who writes in English language? I mean, do you read in Telugu language?
Yeah, I do read. I do read in Telugu. I read Sumati Satakam Padhyalu. Okay. I read Bhimana Satakam Padhyalu.
Okay, I don't know what they are, but that is also poking Mansa right there. She's...
Oh my God, I feel so embarrassed right now.
Okay, Mansa.
Shikhar, why are you like so good?
Look, this is how person elevates in their life. Okay, you need to read regional language literature as well.
I kind of used to read regional languages when I was 6 or 7. My parents gifted me and my brother the Ramayana and Mahabharat.
Okay.
So we used to take turns and read the book.
Nice. So Shrikar, tell me about this transition from, you know, being a extensive reader to accumulating writing skills into your life. When did it start and how did it start?
It started right after my first book. I read A Thousand Love Letters book. That was my first novel. Hmm. After reading that, I instantly fell in love with the art of writing. I wanted to try. So... there was a thought struck in my mind and I wanted to put it on a paper. I wrote an article. I thought that I showed it to my mother. She liked it. She even forwarded it to her friends. They too liked it.
That's so cute.
Thank you. And later on, I thought, why not I publish this on social media? But I was a person who was not on Instagram, was not active on Facebook. I was only using WhatsApp.
Okay, so that explains it. That explains why you got interested in writing.
Yeah. Then okay. After that, I started a blog. Then I started posting few articles. Then I wanted to write fiction. Then I also tried writing few short stories. People liked them, and that encouraged me to explore more. And I even tried my hand at poetry. Then now I'm exploring script writing.
Nice. Great. And what was your first project? Like, how did it start? The blog, you said. What was it about?
It was just about my perspectives. Like, I'm just like, this is what I do. I just turn my perspectives into any form of writing, either articles or stories or poetry. So that blog was about only my perspectives in my articles, which I poured into articles and stories.
Okay. What are your stories like? Are they suspense, thriller, or are they, you know?
They are, I love writing intense stories. Okay. My inspiration is from Ayn Rand. She's an intense writer. Whatever she writes it in an intense tone. So I always prefer going for intensity. So I try to make the emotions more intense in the story, the characters more intense. And I'll try to manage to hold the readers with some suspense. Like, I'm not saying that all my stories are about suspense and thriller.
Okay.
But I'll try to hold them with some suspense, because those are some things like which I have to do in story writing, like raising point and falling point. I have to hold them there.
We just heard Mansa gasp. Okay, Mansa, tell me, why was that?
Okay, because don't judge, but mystery genre, I don't think it's for me.
Why is that?
Like, my anxiety just skyrockets whenever I read a mystery book.
Okay.
Like, I just want to know who the killer is. That's it. And guys, you know, there is this book. I shouldn't have... it's okay. I don't regret it. But there's this book called The Hypnotist by Lars Kepler. And it's one of the best mystery books that I've ever read.
Okay.
Probably was also my last, because I think I started the book at around 10 o'clock at night. Yeah, bad idea. And I stayed up till like 3 a.m. in the morning.
Wow.
I don't know that.
I was just flipping pages because it was so... My anxiety was so bad. I just couldn't get myself to sleep.
Nice.
Like, I remember my mom coming inside my room and she's like, what are you doing? Why are you not sleeping? And I'm like, shush.
Don't disturb. Thinking you're possessed or something.
I swear, I'm not even kidding. That's how she said it. She's like, just go to sleep.
And then Mansa, like, you read a lot of books. Why don't you think of writing something?
Well, okay, guys, you're in for a story. Shru, it's a revelation, because I kind of tried writing.
Oh, nice.
Oh, let me tell you. So I opened Word. And I typed one cold winter morning, and that's it. That's all. Because I just didn't know how to continue.
Writer's block.
Yeah, but that was such a nice opening line, right? On a cold winter morning. I just put a comma and just left it.
You should have continued it with I wore a jacket.
Story end. The end.
Yeah. Unlike me.
Then finish it off with writing the end.
or I could have... Guys, you know what? Okay, this is an idea. Okay. This is my autobiography. It's called Unpredictable. I open the book. I write on a cold winter morning and just leave all the pages blank. Because it's unpredictable. Do you get it?
Yeah, I do.
Like, I am sealing like the whole book so that people won't see the contents inside also.
Maybe you can keep some pages blank and then fill some, and then again keep some blank. that way, you know, yeah, people do not know where you have written it. Written,
so they will read the entire book.
Yeah.
Even better, even better, in the middle page, I'll write, keep going.
Nice.
And then at the end, I'll just be like, congratulations.
You
the
are,
end.
The next day, it will hit New York bestseller.
Exactly. Yeah. Number one. You forgot that hash number one on top.
Yeah. You know, Mansa, I always force you to write book reviews because...
I know.
And why don't you do that, man? Come on.
Well, I don't know. Like, it just... you know, I'm a little lazy, but okay. You know what? I'll actually try writing, okay? Mm-hmm. And also, Shrikar, you know, when you're answering, like, when you're giving all these answers, I can actually hear Shru saying, Seekho kuch. Like, please see Kokoch. You have no idea how much he propels me to do something productive.
Yeah, I think recently you just finished reading 1984, right?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that's awesome. Book is very difficult to comprehend, but yeah, you still managed to finish it.
It is very difficult to comprehend, yeah. I swear.
Yeah, so you have that skill, and I'm telling you, Shrikar, you help me out here. Just, you know, somehow persuade her to write a review. Okay, she's a great writer, trust me. She has written stuff before and I have read it. I am thinking the aim of this podcast, by the end, we will make her to write something, write a review.
Oh, okay. God.
Okay. It's the greatest mantra now.
Yeah. Shrikar, you have left me. You have left me with no option. Now I really know Shru is going to persuade me to write something.
Yeah.
So you have to help me out. How is that?
That is a great thing. You know, Shrikar, since you have written so many things till now, you can, you know, help her out to write new things. Anyway, we'll talk about that later after the podcast. Now, let us talk about Shrikar's favorite part of writing. You know, which one is your favorite? Poetry, blogs, articles, or, you know, stories?
Definitely poetry.
Definitely poetry. I can see that in your Instagram page. Yeah.
Yeah.
So, what is poetry, bro?
Saying a lot in just few words with some music.
That's it.
That's so profound.
Where does the music come from?
Sounding of words, you have to be a bit attentive towards the words.
Yeah.
Snake, sneak, see the cur word, the cur sound.
Oh.
Snake, sneak. That's nice. Consonants. And also, this is popular tongue twister. I hope you're familiar with this. Bitty bot, butter.
Can I go
yeah,
for
please,
it?
Please go on.
Bitty bot some bitter butter, but the bitter butter was not better. So bitty bot some bitter butter to make the bitter butter better.
So what do you observe in this?
I'm not even gonna try that.
That I'm so good at it.
Okay. Apart from that,
I don't know. Betty really needs to have some butter at home.
Okay.
You say it. Don't embarrass us.
Okay, Mansa, let us get serious. Now, Shrikar exactly. Shrikar is, you know, telling his knowledge now.
If you closely observe, every word starts with the same sound. Burr, 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 burr. So, it's alliteration. So, there's music in poetry. We have to observe.
Wow, nice.
And I think every one of us have a milk tongue, like pleasure of saying certain words. So humans are born with that. That's why poetry has descended from centuries. It's been and it still is and it will be forever.
Shru, did you ever want to like read poetry?
I think I used to when I was a kid. I used to like reading poems in Marathi, my mother tongue. I really found pleasure in them whenever I used to read them. Some poems made me cry, some poems made me feel very, very good about myself, and you know. And I also wrote a few of them in Marathi only, in my 10th,
That's
I suppose.
Awesome.
Yeah, so I wrote, but you know, I never continued. I even tried writing something on my Instagram page. A few lines.
Oh.
Yeah, there. It's on my profile. You can check it out. But recently, I have lost the touch. Okay, I never, you know, go extensively towards poetry to read them or to feel something. Sometimes there are Instagram pages, just like Shrikar's. There are pages who write these nice poems, and I go through them. I, you know, stay on that post. I look at it for 2 minutes. I feel nice, and then just move on. It doesn't impact me too much. Probably that is like taking way too much what the poet, what the poem is giving me. You know, there is a lot of potential in poem. It gives you, you know, legion of emotions, and all you have to do is just comprehend it, then, you know, and then just feel everything from it. And I think Shrikar could tell us in a better way what makes poetry different from other forms of writing.
Yeah, before that, I just want to know, like, is Mansa interested in poetry?
Nice.
Did you just sense it? Shrikar, okay, honestly, I really want to read poetry. Like, I really want to understand how poetry feels and everything, but I just don't know how to start and where to start.
Okay, then I'll help you out.
Start from his page.
Done. I'm already on it. I'm reading What Do I Write by him.
How is poetry different from other forms of writing? The first one is attentiveness. Poets are extremely careful about the use of language, the spellings, punctuation, sounding of words, spaces between the words. So they're extremely careful with the language. And concentration. Poetry has more meaning, music, and emotion per word, per syllable, and per letter than all other kinds of writing.
And
the third thing is experimentation. Poets love to experiment. They come up with new ideas, new perspectives, and if they are trying to portray already existing perspective, already known perspective, they try to do it using new metaphors, new similes. Like, they'll come up with new things. They'll experiment more. There's scope to experiment more in poetry than in fiction and other forms of writing, non-fiction. So more experimentation can be done in poetry. I don't think that there are strict rules of grammar in poetry. Like, poets do manipulate a lot of grammar in the poems. You don't have to be a grammar Nazi for writing poetry.
I don't know, my 10th class English teacher would disagree with you.
Then William Shakespeare will come. Because see, the point is, if we stick to grammatical rules, we will we'll compromise the sounding Achha. Of words. The whole point of poetry is to make it more add more music to it.
True
Right. So sometimes poets do compromise grammar, and that's what I said. Like, we don't have to be grammar Nazi to write poetry. That's the main reason I got into this.
Yeah, okay. So basically, focus on feelings.
Yeah, focus on feelings. Like, the way of presentation. Like, what metaphors, what kind of metaphors you're using for that.
Are there any confines to writing poetry? Like, you know, you have to write that poetry in these many words.
There are few traditional poems like haiku and tanka. Like, haiku is both are Japanese forms of poetry. There are also sonnet, Shakespeare's famous sonnets.
What are sonnets?
Sonnets are 14-line poem. They are like couplets.
Okay.
Yeah, so it's a 14-line poem with iambic pentameter. Like, it's it goes like this. Babam, 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 babam. 5 units in each line. Total. Okay. So this pattern continues in 14 lines.
Okay.
So
and is Tanka a 31 syllable poem?
Yeah.
31.
Yeah. 31 syllable poem. Fine.
Written in a single unbroken line.
You're reading my post now. So these are some traditional forms of poetry which has strict rules. Other than that, you can go free verse. You need not worry about a lot of sounding and all that. You can write your heart and mind out. You can just pour in your heart and mind out. But I would suggest that it would be better if you learn some technicalities of poetry so that you can present them even better.
अच्छा
आई कैन सी देर आर सम हाइकू पोम्स इन योर यू नो पेज सो कैन यू लाइक गिव मी सम एग्जांपल ऑफ इट यू नो रीड इट आउट
या श्योर आई विल डू इट सो बेसिकली आई विल गिव एन इंट्रोडक्शन अबाउट हाइकू हाइकू इज अ ट्रेडिशनल जापानीज पोएट्री इट्स अ थ्री लाइन पोएम विद 17 सिलेबस the first line will have 5 syllables, second line will have 7, and the third will have 5 syllables. So haikus are haikus mainly focus about nature. It's about what is happening at this moment. So I wrote four haiku poems. I was sitting in my balcony. So I was just observing the sky and I wrote these things.
Wow.
So
typical.
It goes like this.
Yeah. Yeah, read them out, please.
So it goes like this. Yeah. Haiku 1. Cotton clouds in sky, turning darker and darker, swallowing the sun. This is the first one.
I will stop you there for a moment. You know, when you read that, I couldn't help but get a smile on my face. I don't know why, when you said that.
Same.
Cotton clouds in sky, turning darker and darker, swallowing the sun. There is just some... I don't know if I'm wrong, but I can find
such a beautiful feeling.
Yeah, there is a humor in it that the clouds are swallowing the sun, and still there is something dark going on because there is darkness around. Amazing.
Yeah.
Okay, move on. Yeah.
Second haiku. Wind takes a wild ride, hurling away everything that comes in its way.
Great.
Birds battling the wind to make it to their nest soon as they foresee storm.
Nice.
Flash of fog lightning leap from sky with thunder roar, drenching earth with rain.
Okay, so these haikus are all the things that you saw in front of you and felt.
Yeah, like I was sitting in my balcony, like it was about to rain, so
okay.
I just wrote this haiku. If you closely observe, you can see those 5-7-5-7 syllable pattern in all these haiku poems.
Yeah, definitely. So is there a process for you to write this poetry? You know, if somebody wants to start, do they have to follow some kind of process, fixed process?
I'll give a blueprint. I'll try to give a blueprint to start. But it would be better. Following that, everyone can devise their own way of writing. It pushes them to devise their own way of writing poetry. So the blueprint is like start out with a straightforward prose statement.
Okay.
Then pay closer attention to the details. Like if you write that write sunset, like explain about the details, like how is the sun. It's reddish, orange, or how's the sky?
Okay.
So think about the details. Go for the details. Then the third, try to include some poetic devices like metaphors and similes, also some other technical. I don't want to get into all those things.
Yeah.
So the thing is, don't convey it directly. Like the sun is setting. It's not like that. Like. As I said, like cotton clouds
nothing
in sky.
Nothing poetic about
yeah.
it. Yeah,
cotton clouds in sky, turning darker and darker, swallowing the sun. It's personification, like giving human qualities to clouds. So
okay.
That's where the juice comes from.
Yeah, totally.
So I'm trying.
Yeah.
Okay.
So Mansa, you know, you must have read some of his poems, and do you feel difficulty in understanding them? Do you feel difficulty in reading them?
Well, I'm surprised I actually don't. I mean, it's very simple.
Okay.
And, okay, I think, Shrikar, I'm currently, like, looking at your What Do I Write poem. So, Shru, in it, he says, some say, write your heart out, and the others say, write your mind out.
Okay, nice.
How profound is that?
Yeah.
And how it makes so much sense.
Thank you.
Shrikar, really, how do you come up with these ideas? Like I am taking my pen and paper and going to balcony after this.
Go for it.
What if it's a sunny day and you know it's very hot out there?
I will describe the sun.
Yeah, that's
like
what
he said. See, oh my God, I'm already there.
Yeah. No, you know, reading poetry is also an art because understanding what the writer has to deliver, what the writer wants to tell you, is a difficult task. But it is beautiful in its own way. When you comprehend it from your own perspective, you get different meanings of the same line. Okay, so the poetry could be, the same poetry could be subjective to different people. So, you know, as a poet, Srikar, when you can't explain people that, okay, this is what I want to convey, but people take it in a other way. Okay, so do you feel dissatisfaction or do you feel that urge to correct them? Or do you just say like, okay, fine, they understood it in that way, let them enjoy it?
Let me tell you something. In olden days, in ancient days, like when poets used to write, when ancient poets used to write poetry as well as exact interpretation, what they want the readers want to interpret. They used to write that also. Such that it form and people won't get into misinterpretations, but because there's a wide scope of misinterpretation to happen in poetry.
True.
Because it's totally everything is in indirect way. All those metaphors. If one thing goes wrong, then the corresponding things will go wrong, and you will end up with some other perspective. So what I would suggest is there are two things. Firstly, let me tell you why misinterpretations happen. There are two things for this. First thing is the reader have to take care about this because it's the reader's job. Like they have to have good knowledge about poetry. Good knowledge means what I mean is to have the knowledge about in what situation the poem has been written and do some research about the poet and which era he lived so that you'll understand what was the customs and what was the traditions at that time. So you'll have an idea about that. You'll have an idea about that so that you can understand the poem better. And the second thing, the reader have to take some effort. It's not like reading an article or a story. The reader has to take some effort to understand it well, to get the most out of it. You have to have some knowledge.
Go on.
And the second thing is the writer's job, the poet's job. See, there are two things in poetry. One is abstractions and imagery. Abstractions are the things which we cannot feel them with our five senses. For example, time. We cannot feel them with our five senses. But time has symbols like clock.
Yeah.
If I say clock is ticking, we mean time time is passing. So misinterpretations happen when the poet is unable to portray his abstractions, that is his own ideas, with appropriate imagery. If there is not appropriate imagery or adequate imagery for the abstractions, then the misinterpretation happens. It's like putting a lot of work on reader's shoulder. Then their misinterpretation happens. So both of them should be careful, the poet as well as the reader.
You know, I think major obstructions where happen for readers is the whenever they come across difficult vocabularies, because since poets have to finish their poem in limited words or they just like to keep it short, they use very difficult vocabularies which are not familiar to someone like us, suppose from India. We just lose interest because there is very difficult line or there is difficult word to understand. So do you think that's something on the writer's part, or the reader has to take some effort to just comprehend it?
I think it's the reader's job, I guess, because the poet, I mean, we can't tell the poet to use some other word because he has done enough research and he came up with the right word, which he feels right. We cannot say it's the fault of the poet. I think it would be better for the readers to start with some basic poetry, like simple poetry, where okay. they don't find these difficult words. Like they can start with few haikus, as well as they can go for Maya Angelou poetry, which are like these modern poems are simple. I don't recommend reading ancient poetry like William Shakespeare, John Donne. No, don't do that. So start with some simple modern poetry. Then you'll fall in love with the art of poetry. Then you'll love reading them. Then you can shift to the ancient poetry, which are very profound as well as awesome.
Yeah. Do you have any recommendation?
Read my poetry.
I am already on it.
No, I mean...
So through you're late.
Yeah. No, I mean, do you know any book that we can refer to or we can read, which might get us interested into poetry even more?
I would suggest you to go through anthologies, poetry anthologies. Those anthologies are written
I'm
by...
I'm writing it down.
Okay.
Same.
I don't remember the titles, but you can search them on Google. You can read some anthologies. Like these anthologies are written by the students, mostly students. Even I have participated in few. The students they all, and also you can follow people like Jidnya Sujata on Instagram. These people you can find them on Spill Poetry. Are you familiar with Spill Poetry on YouTube channel?
I don't think so.
Okay, like I would recommend
also these poems by Rupi Kaur or somebody keep popping up on my feed. Have you heard of her, Rupi Kaur?
I have heard of her. Yeah.
Okay.
Rupi Kaur. But I would suggest go through the Spill Poetry YouTube channel and Tape a Tale YouTube channels. There you can find many amateur poets, not amateur, but good poets. There you can find good poets. They use simple language. They narrate it so well. They read it so well. You can understand them. The thing is, poetry is not meant to read, not meant for just eye and mind. It's to be given voice. So you'll enjoy more listening to poems. So it would be better if you guys go through those channels and listen to some of their poems and then read some anthology poems, then pick up some modern poets' poems, then go for ancient poetry.
Okay.
And do you have any favorite poem of yours, somebody else's work?
Somebody else's work.
I had to mention it, right?
Exactly. I was going to say the same.
Yeah, I do have. It's a poem by Emily Dickinson. There's a poem. Should I read it?
Yeah, you can.
Yeah. So it goes like this. I dwell in possibility, a fairer house than prose, more numerous of windows, superior for doors. Here possibility means it's a metaphor for poetry.
Okay.
She's basically saying that poetry is more beautiful, more profound than prose. So I dwell in possibility, a fairer house than prose, more numerous of windows, superior for doors. Of chambers as the cedars, impregnable of eye, and for an everlasting roof, the gamblers of the sky. Of vistas, the fairest, for occupation, this, the spreading wide my narrow hands to gather paradise. Just look at the last line. The spreading wide my narrow hands to gather paradise.
Wow. Yeah.
So this is my favorite poem. Like, I know it's a kind of difficult one. Like,
yeah, I not... could I think I can understand only 50% of it.
Yeah.
Or 60.
Yeah. When you explained the first two lines, then I got the idea, okay, this is what it is about. Otherwise I was going in some other direction.
Wait, I'll just give you some explanation, Saleng.
Yeah, sure.
Okay. The explanation goes like this. I live in a house called Possibility, a metaphor for poetry. This is a more beautiful and truthful house than one called prose. It has far more windows and better doors than prose does. The house of possibility has rooms as strong as cedar door into which the outside world can't see. For its eternal roof, the house has the sky itself, endless possibilities. Visitors to this house are the most beautiful and virtuous kinds of people. My job here is the one I'm doing right now. Opening my own little hands, I collect poetry, the divine substance of the heavens themselves.
Very deep, right?
Yeah.
Very, very profound.
Yeah.
I'm considering to change the name of my autobiography.
Oh, what's the new name?
Endless possibilities. Or maybe I'll just put a tagline like unpredictable, uske niche, endless possibilities with three dots.
Unpredictable below that.
Again, yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, fine. You know, Mansa, you must have read some poems as a kid, or at least some you must have come across somewhere. So, do you remember any such poem that you liked a lot?
Well, not outside academics for sure. So, maybe I think the last poem, please don't ask me about it. I just remember the title. It's called Ozymandias. We had this in our 10th. So, yeah.
Even I do remember that.
You do? Oh.
Yeah, I remember it. You know, my favorite, not favorite, but I remember this poem from my heart even today because it is very emotional. It was in Marathi, I think when I was in 7th grade. So, this poem is about a bull, okay, and a farmer. So the bull is personified. The bull is, you know, writing the story. It is very, very emotional. He starts with, you know, how the bull came into farmer's life and helped him a lot to do so many chores. Like, you know, bulls do a lot of stuff, you know. They are used for so many tasks. So the bull is like, even though you use me, you still give me that love from your side. I am very grateful for that. And the once in a year in Maharashtra, there is a festival for all the cows and all the cattle, actually, all the cattle. We do puja of them. We give them a day off. We give them great food. We give them nice clothes. Clothes in the sense we cover them with nice design of shawls and everything. We get them ready and they are paraded throughout the whole town, whole village. Okay, that is one festival. So he's like, whole year I work for you, and then, you know, once year you do this for me, and I'm very, you know, happy for that also. Once a year I get to eat something sweet, and that bull goes on telling his story, like, okay, this is what happens in my life. I'm, you know, grateful for this and all that stuff. In the end, what happens? Now he is old. Okay, the bull is old. And the bull ends the poem with, I have worked for you, I have served you all this time, and thank you for having me. And I wish that when I die, the skin of my body will make a good chappal for you, good footwear for you. So it ends with that.
That's so emotional.
Yeah. And, you know, my teacher was amazing. He used to read out poems in that very intense fashion. He used to get involved in it. And, you know, his modulation of voice, everything. When the bull starts crying, he created that shivering sound through his voice. Can you imagine?
Wow.
That made this poem even more special.
You're lucky to have such a great teacher.
Beautiful. Yeah. I'm still feeling emotional.
Yeah, because
it's so beautiful. It just shows what gratefulness actually is.
Yeah, true. And there is this, Mansa, I don't know if you have watched this movie, but there is this movie called Dead Poets Society.
Yeah, I watched it. Yeah.
Oh, Shru, I'm going to surprise you. I did.
Really? Nice.
Half.
Nice.
Half of it. Like, till they find the... till they find that spot, na? The secret spot.
Yeah, the
where
cave.
You...
Okay,
this
cave.
Is why I'm telling you, I want to read poetry. I just don't know where to start.
You know, just stop giving excuses and you pick up something, what you find, I think you will do great.
Yeah, Shru, you're so mean.
No, that's what happens. Even I, look at me, whenever I say I want to read that book, but you know, I don't know what to do. So these are excuses, right? Everybody, if they want to do something, just pick something up, go ahead. The way you do it with books, you know, you just pick a book and just keep reading and reading. I think you are finishing...
Yes.
A book per week. You're reading at that pace.
It was because it was like, you know, it's dystopian only, but 1984 was also, you know, I just had to finish it somehow. So
okay.
I was just going at a very fast pace.
Yeah, nice. So yeah, I was talking about the Dead Poets Society. I think when I have watched other movies which include poetries and all that stuff, but this one was very special. This one touched my soul. This one showed me that poetry is for everybody. You know, poetry is something everyone should, you know, feel. Everyone should read and feel the emotions. I was really relieved to, you know, just remember all the poems that I had read in my school. I went online and I went through them again. You can imagine what kind of impact that movie had on me. I really thought about poetry in a different way after watching that movie. So, Srikat, tell me, what do you do to keep your poetry good?
I read a lot of poetry.
Okay.
That's the first thing you have to do. Like, because you'll get to know the more different ways of expressing the things. Like, there are many poems whose theme is based on sea, and different people present it in different manners, different ways.
True.
So, that's what I mean. To be a good poet, to enhance your poetry, I would suggest to read a lot of poetry. And also listen to poetry. And while you're reading, read it aloud. Just be conscious about the sounds. And the most important thing is never settle for cliche. Don't use the same metaphors. If you feel like this has already been used, don't go for it. Go for the new one. Go for your metaphor. Go for your analogy.
Simile is where you use the word like, I suppose, right?
Yeah, this.
Or is that the metaphor?
This is a major confusion. This is the biggest confusion.
Yeah.
So let me break down. As you said, in similes we do use like, but it's not only that. See, the thing is, the major difference is, I'll give an example. Cotton clouds. This is metaphor. And clouds are like cotton. This is simile. So what is happening here? In metaphors, we change the nature. I'm saying clouds are cotton. And in simile, I'm not changing the nature of clouds. I'm not ultimately saying clouds are cotton. I'm just showing the similarity between them. Simile is a bit subtle one. Metaphor is a bit intense. Like it gives an ultimatum, like this cloud, cotton clouds. And simile, clouds are like cotton.
Man, Srikar, you should really become a teacher, man. You should become a poetry teacher.
I swear.
I understood this difference in a quick second. Trust me.
You know, I was not going to be wrong about it anyways, because this is one of the questions that was asked in the class by my teacher. She said, does simile include the work like or no? And I very confidently said no. So, like, I'm going to remember this forever.
Yeah, thanks. Man, you very nicely and calmly, you know, differentiated these two. It was very easy to understand after your explanation. You should really think about becoming a teacher, man.
I'm planning a poetry course.
Yeah. Hey, Srikar, you know, if you actually pursue this, poetry and everything, you might as well be like that a teacher in Dead Poets Society, hai na, Shru?
True. But he will also go through such situations, difficult situations.
Yeah, poetry won't pay your bills.
Like, do you really think so? Can we make money by writing poetry? Don't you think?
We can make money, but we can't go like quit the job and write poetry. we can make money from poetry, like from participating in few competitions, like performing live, collaborating with some YouTube channels like Spill Poetry and Tip Patel. We can go for that. We can monetize to some extent, but I don't think we can make a lot of money from this.
Okay.
Once if you get the good recognition, your books will
pay you well.
You'll get your books will be sold, and also if you start a poetry course on Udemy or any other platform, teaching platform, then slowly, it's not like it will happen quickly. It's not
true.
It will take time, but if the person is persistent, then maybe things might change, like he can make money. But I would advise that don't quit your jobs.
but to also do all of that, you need to have profound knowledge of poetry. You can't be superficial about it and just go ahead and try to do all these things, because you can't survive that kind of environment if you don't have that deep knowledge.
Like one should ask oneself that question, that if I do my poetry course now, will people listen to me? Am I capable? It would be better if they can experiment it on social media, how people are reacting to your poems. If now I have explained about metaphor and simile, if I do it on Instagram, the same video, are people engaging well? So all this data, we can get this data from social media. Then depending upon that, we can act.
Yeah. I think major obstruction that poetry faces is it is visual most of the times. It forces people to read it, and most of the people who are on social media, they have very narrow point of concentration. Okay, they like to just go quickly from one post to other. They don't like to stay, read and understand what is written in these 10-15 lines. So I think that is major obstruction, and that could be overcome by audio. That is one other media that can take down the harshness, level of difficulty, and that can attract many audience also. What if you start, reading out poems and putting those audios on Instagram? Why don't you do that?
I'm planning those things. I'm planning to make reels to read out my poetry. But for that, I'm planning to do it in such a way that I'll do some animation and give voiceover, such that I'll be making more engagement.
That's a great idea.
People like to see animation, right?
They want
some figures to popping up. So that's why I'm doing this video editing courses. Once I'm done with them, I'll definitely do those things. And most importantly, poetry is meant to be given voice. It's not for eye and mind. It's for the sounding.
That's what.
I also think you have a very nice voice for poetry.
I know, right? Very subtle bass voice, and he has that charisma to it, crispness to it.
Like how he explained the metaphor and simile without any fuss. This is this, and that is this.
Mansa likes my singing a lot. Anyway, moving on.
Yeah.
Man, Srikar, what do you think these songs, these Bollywood songs or Tollywood songs, are those poetry?
They are not poetry. They just want some commercial hits.
He is just so
there's
tired
a lot
of them.
There's a lot of objectifying, man. Seriously, lot of objectifying.
Probably that's metaphor for them.
I literally, I hate those lines. I hate those lyrics. I stopped listening to the these Bollywood and even Tollywood lyrics now, like modern day things. I love listening to old songs as well as instrumental music. That's it.
Okay. Wait a second. I think you will love Tony Kakkar's songs. You should really check them out.
I won't. I don't even like Neha Kakkar. Why would I go for Tony Kakkar?
Yeah, but Shru and I really like those old Bollywood songs.
You don't.
I do. Hello.
Okay, name one. Your favorite one.
Of course I can. Ajeeb Dasta Hai Ye. And Aajkal Tere Mere Pyaar. Shru, come on, yaar. We spoke about this.
Yeah, I think. Bro, I think recently, in recent time, this Bollywood music and all of that, I think there are a few writers who songwriters. They do incredible job. Some of them are Swanand Kirkire. I also like Amit Trivedi. Man, amazing.
I love Amit Trivedi.
Amazing, right? And there are...
Amazing.
Yeah. So these songwriters, they are very, very, you know, profound when it comes to music industry and getting a deep meaning through their song. So don't you think that could be very similar to poetry?
Yeah, it's definitely similar to poetry. Songwriting is definitely similar to poetry because the songwriting happens with corresponding to the beat.
Yeah.
First, the song and music director gives a beat, and according to that beat, the lyricist writes the lyrics. So there's a lot of passion and music into songwriting. So it's very similar to poetry. As you said, there are some good writers even now, and in Telugu I can name Chandra Bose. He's a great songwriter. And also this
Sriram Shastri or someone also.
Yeah, that's what it's wait a second.
And somebody's name that starts with V also, no?
Sirivellana Sita Rama Shastri. He's an awesome
writer. Said
That's him, yeah. He's an awesome writer, man. If there are any Telugu audience, I would suggest them to go listen to his songs. The metaphors he uses, the words, and he plays with the sounds.
Okay.
I love that.
Okay. Do you listen to rap music?
No, I don't like that. I don't like rap music.
Okay, guys, just a minute. I think I found a metaphor for like a Hindi Bollywood lyric song.
Okay,
go
Mera
on.
Mera pyar, 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 hookah bar.
Yeah, exactly. What is it?
What the hell does that mean?
Damn.
It's a metaphor for them, obviously. There's poetry in Bollywood.
Yeah, there
so
is.
So whoever
is.
Said there's no... poetry in Bollywood.
I won't argue that. But what I feel personally is rap is more like poetry. Trust me. Rap is so much more like poetry. It is probably very aggressive and, there are foul words used and it is very violent and there are so many elements to it, but it is so much like poetry. They do not go by some pattern. That is also there. They do not go by some pattern. They go by storytelling. So I personally feel that if anything is very similar to poetry, that is rap in modern art.
Let me tell you one thing. I'm not into rap songs, but I saw this movie, Ranveer Singh's movie. What is it?
Gully Boy.
Yeah. I saw it in theater. I really like the movie.
I know, right?
Yeah, I really like the movie. I'm not well versed in Hindi, but I could pick up some good lyrics, which were like so emotional and so aggressive. That's so nice. And this particular lyric, like "Yashad Donkey Jwala, Meri Bediya Piglayegi," that one hit me so hard. And after that, I started writing poetry. That lyric that lyric was such an inspiration for me. Okay. Then after that, I wrote my first poem. So, okay. I'm not into rap, but as you said...
Yeah, it impacted you somehow.
Yeah, it impacted me.
You know, I would share some rap music with you, English ones. Trust me, when you listen to it, you will be like, okay, this is something I never expected. There are some three-dimensional rap starts, very simple. It goes deep and then it goes beyond this world. There are such raps. Yeah, I'll share each one of them. Okay, don't worry.
Yeah, please. I'd love to hear them.
Yeah. Do you get approached by girls after writing this poetry?
Most of my poems are feministic poems. So, okay. Most of the girls like my poems.
Okay.
They, got a lot of praise for my poems.
Mm.
But nothing went for a date. It didn't go to that extent.
Do you think there is more inclination towards your poem by girls than boys?
Yeah, I think there is. Actually, the point is I wanted to write a novel about the silent suffering of a woman. We people usually talk about rape and household assaults and all this. What happens, what can be seen. We usually talk about these things. Mm. But there's also a lot of silent suffering going for the woman.
True.
Yeah, the simple thing, if there is a girl and a boy and a grandmother, the grandmother calls the boy in a certain way and the girl in a certain way. So, there's a bias. And these things will affect the girl. So, as well as marital rape, is most is a silent suffering, marital rape.
True.
Mm-hmm.
So, I even wrote a
I'm
poem
I'm still
on
surprised.
That.
Yeah.
And the worst part is we don't even have a law for that, to punish them.
Exactly, I was going to say that.
To punish them, we don't have a law in India. So... I wanted to write that novel, but it didn't happen because writing a novel, it takes a lot of time. I wasn't ready and I didn't have the necessary skill at that point of time. So I had the ideas, what all silent suffering a woman goes. I had some ideas body shaming, marital rape. So yeah. I turned those ideas into poems.
Nice.
There's a lot of social condition happening, right from the childhood. The kids are being socially conditioned in certain fashion. Mm. And even also for men, men are told to be not to cry.
Yeah.
Not to be strong.
Yeah.
So all the social conditioning is a root cause. And for cooking, I would say that the thing is, I view cooking as a survival skill.
I know, right? Same.
Okay.
I believe the same. I was actually going to post it on my story also. I have started cooking on my own. I'm learning. Okay. And I believe everyone should learn cooking. And I have told this to Mansa also. Cooking is a survival skill. The exact same words.
True.
Yeah, that's what, it's a survival skill. Everyone should learn that. You can experiment. It's also a skill. You'll find joy in doing that.
True.
The social conditioning, because of the social conditioning, the society is inclined that only women should do. Women are supposed to do the cooking part. It's not like that.
I remember my own relatives, when my brother was crying, they used to wipe his tears and be like, why are you crying like a girl?
Uh-huh.
And I used to stand there, I'm like, okay.
Yeah, that's the. But times have changed about only women should be in kitchen. Mm. That was probably once applicable in those ancient times when the physical dominance was required to survive outside, and the care and the nurturing nature was required inside the house. That was the condition in those days. But now it's different, right? You don't have to struggle a lot for surviving. So these things just dilute. There are no jobs stereotyped according to genders. There are no genders who are made for certain type of jobs. So you can always say that phase is over and one should learn every single survival skill. cooking, even other skills. Like, women should also become strong. So, yeah, we were talking about... So, what about romance? Do you write a lot of romantic poems?
Yeah, I wrote few. I wrote few romantic poems too.
Mm-hmm. Okay, read it out and tell what you meant by it.
So, the title is, You're My Person.
Nice. I'm already interested.
I am blushing.
Okay.
When I was overwhelmed by the dark, vicious clouds, you were my sun, shining through, brightening my world with the rays of hope. When I was knocked out in the ring of life, lying unconscious, you were my tight slap of resurrection, bringing me back to life, making me conscious again. When I was at the shore, alone and lost, you were my sea, reaching out in waves, cheering me every now and then, taking away my grief and loneliness. When I was a budding plant, growing little by little and little every day, you were my caring farmer, finding joy in my growth. When I was an evolving caterpillar, trying to break the cocoon, you were the strength in my wings, helping me turn into a butterfly and fly high. When I was stuck in a storm or drowned in the ocean of joy, you were there still, you are there and will be there, because you're my person, my love and my everything.
Oh.
So sweet.
Thank you, thank you.
Shru, did you ever write a poem for someone?
Okay, I think I did, maybe, I don't know. I might have.
You did?
I guess, I don't know.
Really?
I might have just copied the... I might...
This is what amazing.
Yeah, yeah. For. 10 things I hate about you. So the the poem in the end, I might have copied that, but that applied. So I guess
you just modified it a little.
Yes. Mm. Anyway, nice. So back to Srikar, man, amazing. Do you also write poems for other people, like your friends and family?
Friends and family, I haven't tried. Like, I want
or
to.
Or people
write.
You do podcast with?
I will write one for sure.
Okay, Srikar, I'm waiting. Don't include Shru.
I wrote few poems, but those were out of anger. I couldn't shout. I couldn't vent my anger on them. So I chose the poetry.
Nice.
Wow.
So everybody, helps you
everyone has that way of escaping.
Yeah, like after writing that, you'll feel like you'll get back to your peace.
Hmm.
Yeah, this is what I want to say. It's over, right?
Yeah. Nice.
Because like, if I go and say all those things, like it would definitely damage the relationship. But I can't keep quiet as well as I can't go and say it. So poet comes to this like poet saves here.
Yeah. Okay, so man, I think we have reached the end of our discussion and it was amazing, right?
Yeah, it was really awesome. Nice. I really enjoyed it.
I laughed a lot.
Thank you, Srikar.
Thank you too, Mansa, for the most unpredictable moments.
Somebody thank me, please.
Thank you.
Sorry. Okay, thank you.
For organizing this.
Yeah.
I've already thanked you. I said thank you for gently persuading me into doing this.
Okay, you know, Srikar,
notice how I avoided using the word manipulate.
Srikar,
yeah.
You were also...
becoming a poet.
Yeah. Oh, nice.
That's a compliment. Oh my God.
Srikar, you were also one of the reasons why she chose to come. You know, she wanted to talk about poetry with you. And of course, she reads a lot, so that makes sense, right?
I'm glad. And thank you, bro, like organizing this event. I was really excited when you asked me for doing a poetry podcast.
Okay, guys, thank you and have a good day. Stay safe. Bye.
You too, man.
You too. Bye.
Bye.
Bye, Srikar.
Bye, Mansa. Take care. Bye, Shru.
Bye.
Take care.